colleagues. I thank all the delegates who are doctors and paramedical persons, and some of my patients are also present. I thank I'm thankful to them also. After my talk, I will request the audience to put their questions in the chat box so that I can answer them after my talk is over. Okay, now I'll start my talk. So topic given to me for today's webinar is ST relation microinfarction management in COVID, during COVID time. As we know, COVID-19, like any other virus, may trigger acute microinfarction by multiple pathways. The mechanisms could be inflammation caused by the infection, hypoxia, or increased prothrombotic or thrombogenic potential, which is there in the COVID status. Apart from that, COVID virus has got the tendency to infect the heart directly by causing myocarditis, cardiac failure, or arrhythmias. So those patients who are cardiac patients, they have increased risk of death because of the COVID infection if they got. Underlying mechanisms which are responsible for this, they carry the great importance, so that the treatment should be accurate and can be promptly offered, and so that mortality can be reduced.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, sir.
Tell me, please.
Sir, slides are not moving. If you are, I mean, it is on your.
No. I'm not moving. I'm sorry.
Okay, sir.
Hypertension counts to 30% approximately. Diabetes to 12%. Comorbidities like CRF malignancy, which are there in the COVID-19 patients. Now, new challenges in managing these ST elevation myocardial infarction patients during COVID-19. Already in our country, we have so many challenges in handling the myocardial infarction patients. On the top of that, COVID-19 has created additional burden. So we'll see one by one what are those challenges. First is the patient delay. Often due to existing nationwide lockdown, due to lack of transportation and lack of routine medical services, at first medical contact, or a patient just simple phobia of contacting the infection from the healthcare system often delays the patient. Secondly, there is a shortage of centers performing the COVID test. So COVID status is most of the time unknown when the patient arrives in the emergency room. To top up the confusion, troponin values are most of the time high in COVID-19 infection. They are also high in myocardial infarction or myocarditis. So it again adds to the confusion. So always there is constant need to assess the risk-benefit ratio of acute EMI intervention with the reperfusion against nosocomial infection risk. This is a very important slide. Two very big stalwarts in cardiology are shown in this slide, Eugene Broadwald and Bernard Gersch. So we know that basically, this myocardial infarction happens because of the thrombus formation in the coronary artery, leading to compromising the circulation in the distal territory. Suppose here there is a blockage, the distal myocardium will be deprived of the oxygen, blood, and important nutrients. So the main intervention is, main aim should be to open up this vessel. So the time is muscle. This statement is given right 50 years back by Eugene Broadwald. It was mentioned in 1971. So our aim should be prompt restoration of this anterograde blood flow. That should be our core aim in ST elevation myocardial infarction. Here in this graph, Bernard Gersch has shown very nicely. Here on the x-axis, you can see time from symptom onset to reperfusion therapy. On y-axis, you see the percentage of myocardium which is saved. So if thrombolysis is performed within 1 hour, so the myocardium will be salvaged. The more myocardium will be salvaged. So time is muscle here. So this slide is very nicely depicting the inverse relationship between the time of time duration between reperfusion and the extent of myocardium damage. It was published in JAMA Journal in 2005 by Bernard Gersh. I have got an opportunity to meet Professor Bernard Gersh last year in one of the conferences. He is one of the legend in cardiology, basically from USA, right now practicing in South Africa, I think. He is Mr. Bernard Gersh. Now coming to the, what are the modalities of revascularization? So you want to open up these vessels. So revascularization can be achieved via primary PCI, thrombolysis, or timely thrombolysis with early PCI. That is also called as pharmacoinvasive approach. So we will see one by one what is primary PCI. Primary PCI is stenting or angioplasty performed immediately, ideally within 90 minutes, but it can be performed up to 12 hours without prior administration of fibrinolytic agent or antiplatelet agents. But in certain situations, like when the chest pain is persistent or there are signs of ischemia are there on ECG persistently, or hemodynamic instability is there, then, or arrhythmias are there, then PCI can be performed up to 24 hours. Second option we have is thrombolysis, in which a drug is given to break the thrombus, which is obstructing the flow. We have different agents, like in older days we used to use streptokinase, urokinase. Nowadays we are with newer agents like tenecteplase, retiplase, or alteplase. Third approach is the pharmaco-invasive approach, in which if the PCI is delayed due to some or the other reason, initially thrombolysis is done and we buy or purchase the time, and then the patient is posted for PCI. This is called pharmaco-invasive approach. For management or for any diagnosis purpose, protocol or guidelines are important. Similarly, there are protocols made in countries as vast as India. This revascularization strategy, it varies significantly from place to place, hospital to hospital. So by forming the protocol or guidelines, they help us to uniformly form the standards, so that uniform STEMI management and standard of care should be taken, and they help in defining timeliness and effective and safe management strategy that is easily accessible to mass. They also help in optimum utilization of limited resources. So there are guidelines given by Cardiological Society of India regarding the management of ST elevation MI. Initially, they have given guidelines for a diagnostic approach. Whenever a patient with ischemic chest pain presents, so on ECG, if there is ST segment elevation, he is labeled as a case of ST elevation myocardial infarction. So we will be dealing today with this entity. If patient doesn't have ST elevation, either if the troponin values are raised, then he will be labeled as non-ST elevation MI, or if the troponins are normal with no ST elevation, it will be called unstable angina. So these three entities, unstable angina, non-STEMI and STEMI, they constitute acute coronary syndrome. So our talk is now regarding only ST elevation myocardial infarction. Next slide, please. They have proposed the triage, means timely presentation or timely management as per the location of the patient. What happens if the patient belongs to a big city like a corporate Mumbai, Kolkata or Delhi, they have got easy approach to cath labs. So if a patient of ST elevation MI from these cities, they present to the cath lab, then the best option is primary PCI, primary percutaneous angioplasty. If due to some reason it is not feasible, or if the patient is financially not affordable, then there is the option of hospital-based thrombolytic therapy. Again, there are two options. Either it could be a successful thrombolysis, then later on he can be subjected for planned angiography that can be labeled as pharmacoinvasive approach. Or if there is a failed thrombolysis, then he has to be taken up for rescue percutaneous intervention. Similarly, if patient belongs to small town or taluka place, he should be thrombolized because it will be difficult for him to access the cath lab. So he should be first thrombolized, and depending upon the result, either he can go for pharmacoinvasive therapy later on within 3 hours to 24 hours, or he can be posted for rescue PCI. This is emergency. If the thrombolysis fails, immediately rescue PCI is to be done immediately. If patient is from a very remote place or a very small town, thrombolysis should be done in nearby hometown, small taluka place. Then later, both the options, rescue PCI as well as pharmacoinvasive therapy, are open for the patient. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. So treatment will differ as per the facility of PCI centers. In non-PCI centers, we will see once the patient of atrial myocardial infarction presents within 12 hours, he should be started with oxygen, aspirin, loading dose of clopidogrel, high dose of statins and heparin. Then he should be taken up for reperfusion. You should decide about the reperfusion strategy. Mainly they are guided by patient consent and hemodynamic stability and previous history of any thrombolysis or something like that. If it is possible to transfer him to PCI capable center, if percutaneous angioplasty can be done within 120 minutes, that is primary PCI. That is one option if the PCI center is nearby. If it is distant, then if the patient has presented to you with ST elevation MI, within 30 minutes, he should be thrombolized. If it is a successful thrombolysis, he should be started with beta blockers and angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers. If it is a successful thrombolysis, later on, PCI can be done within 3 to 24 hours. Or if it is a failed thrombolysis or unsuccessful thrombolysis, then immediate transfer for PCI for rescue angioplasty is mandatory. If thrombolysis is incapable, patient belongs to a center where the thrombolysis is incapable, then he should be shifted to the center where the thrombolysis is possible. Next slide, please. Scenario is a bit different in the centers where the PCI facility is available. If patient goes there within 12 hours of having ST elevation MI, if the patient is primarily initially thrombolized, he has the option of getting his PCI done within 3 to 24 hours post thrombolysis. Well, if PCI is not feasible, then he has the option of medical management by keeping him in ICU. If he is non-thrombolized, if he is affordable or PCI is feasible, then primary PCI can be tried, which is a better option slightly. If PCI is not feasible, then he should be thrombolized. Patient presenting between 12 to 24 hours, if they are thrombolized already, there is an option of pharmacoinvasive approach. Second option of plain managing them in ICU is there, available. If they are not thrombolized, then again, patient, if it is feasible for him, he can be taken up to the cath lab for opening up the vessel. If he has persistent signs of angina, signs of ischemia on the ECG or chest pain, similarly, late thrombolysis can be done. If he has persistent ischemic changes in the ECG or there is chest pain persistently. Next slide, please. Next slide. One statement is made by the Cardiological Society of India regarding COVID-19. The Cardiological Society of India thanked and appreciated the sincere efforts of all the private as well as government bodies, local state health authorities, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, and Medical Indian Council of Medical Research also, in planning out or in giving out response plans for containing and limiting and suppressing the pandemic of COVID. The purpose of giving this position statement was just to supplement the valuable guidance from these bodies, not to override it. Next slide, please. We'll see now what are the recommendations given by the Cardiological Society of India regarding reperfusion strategy for AMI. Any patient who is coming to cath lab, he should be screened fully for the history of international travel or contact with a COVID patient or his relative, or he should be asked for the history of fever with respiratory symptoms on presentation. That respiratory status of the patient should be well assessed and classified. We can classify these patients coming out into three groups. Next. Group A is a positive COVID test patients who are confirmed COVID-19 patients. Now the number in our country is gradually increasing and it may increase further. Group B is suspected COVID patients, those who have history of international travel or close contact with COVID patient or their relatives or have the respiratory symptoms. They should be rapidly tested and they fall into the group B, a suspected COVID-19 patient. Then the third group is COVID negative group or group C, where there are no symptoms suggestive of influenza. There is no history of travel or contact with COVID-19 patients and COVID-19 test is flatly negative. Next. As far as management is concerned, this group A and group B both should be combined, clubbed together because of non-availability of rapid testing often most of the time. And for these patients belonging to group A, group B, confirmed or suspected COVID with ST elevation mitral infarction presenting within 12 hours, if there are no contraindications and if they are hemodynamically stable, thrombolysis is the best prudent option to avoid the time delay. And for the protection of cardiac cath lab members from getting infected, if the patient is hemodynamically stable, as I said. On the contrary, if the patient is hemodynamically unstable, a primary PCI would be the choice, especially if the patient has COVID-19 pneumonia, respiratory status is in trouble. So primary PCI would be better. Thrombolysis could still be tried in such patients if you have fear of getting infection in the cath lab with proper rescue angioplasty ready and due to prevailing logistic problems. Next, please. As I said, rescue PCI should be done where those patients were lately presented beyond 12 hours, and especially if pneumonia is moderate, and provided appropriate personal protection equipment is available, including whole body cover, head cover, face shield, gloves, foot cover and face mask. Definitely primary PCI should not be performed if adequate personal protection equipment is not there. And ideally it should be performed in a designated isolated cath lab, which is designed for this purpose. And it is every time the procedure finishes, the cath lab should be sterilized with the appropriate chemical agent. And a number of 10 personnel who are attending the cath lab, they should also be less in number to reduce the nosocomial spread. Based on the prevailing logistics, Group C patients who are COVID negative, thrombolysis remains the best option to decrease overall critical care and inpatient service burden. Next. For non-ST segment elevation patient, stable patients, intervention should be avoided until their test comes negative, and they should be managed on conservative line of treatment. When you want to give the thrombolysis, it should be given in designated ICU with due precaution in isolation room so that it should not be contagious to others. I'm talking about the patients who are confirmed, who are falling in confirmed or suspected group. Again, in small towns and villages, it is better to go for thrombolysis as a preferred reperfusion strategy, and transfer should be discouraged during such period. Next slide, please. How should be the preparedness of the cardiovascular care team who is going to perform in the cath lab or ICCU? What precautions they should take? First of all, they should protect themselves first, not only to avoid getting themselves, but also to prevent nosocomial infection. Because in China, Wuhan, it was reported that 41 approximately percent of the patient transmission occurred, it was hospital related. So protecting yourself first should be the top priority. Then appropriate personal protection equipment is of definitely paramount importance as per the national and international advisories. And those patients who have respiratory distress, pneumonia, or in the early ARDS, better to take inside the cath lab with the prior planned intubation so as to avoid excessive aerosol generation in the cath lab. And as far as possible, 2D echo should be ordered only if it contributes to decision making so as to avoid contact between the cardiologist and the patient for a long time. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. So to summarize whatever I have said up till now, it was the part one of this CME. Hypertension and diabetes contributes to the most common comorbidities associated with coronary artery disease, and then comes a number of chronic renal disorders, leukemia, malignancies, and all. COVID-19 can trigger cardiac complications, AMI particularly, by multiple mechanisms. As said earlier, there is increased thrombogenic potential in the COVID patients. COVID patient can directly affect the cardiac myocytes. It can cause inflammation and disturb the performance of platelets, and endothelial dysfunction can be there. Sepsis, hypoxia can be there. So already these patients are, their myocardium is already compromised, those patients. On the top of it, COVID-19 is going to damage it further and can trigger MI. Regarding challenges in managing MI, already our country is facing a lot of challenges in managing in routinely the patients of MI. There are further new challenges added during COVID-19, like I said, nationwide lockdown, lack of transportation, fear in the public of getting infection in the hospital, and most of the primary family physicians have kept their offices closed. So these are the new challenges which the people they are facing. So thrombolysis seems to be the prudent and safe option to avoid time delay. And of course, as a generalized statement, individualized treatment and decision on drug therapy is the need of our. Next part, please. As I said earlier, as all of you know, our country has a lot many population, tremendous burden of this disease, and we have comparatively less number of STEM care centers or ECG facility centers. We lack in patient awareness also. We lack in physician readiness, like physician inertia in hypertensive patients, treatment we call. We do have lack of equipped ambulance systems in network in our country. So these contribute to excess mortality and poorer outcomes of myocardial infarction in our country. On the contrary, if you compare with Europe and developed countries, I had the opportunity last year to attend one meeting in Munich, Germany, where I was listening to Bernard Gersch. So there he said that in America, they have very much strong and dedicated STEMI care system. Every 1 or 2 kilometers, you will find a cath lab over there. And just patient has to dial a particular number. Air ambulance will come and it will pick up the patient. Within half an hour, patient will be there in the cath lab. So the scenario is totally different in our country. So things will change. I hope we'll try to improve out of this. Next slide, please. So the selection of reperfusion strategy in STEMI, we will see. As I said, time is muscle and muscle is life, as said by Eugene Braunwald, father of cardiology. So reperfusion timely results in better preservation of myocardium and better preservation of ejection fraction. So the right reperfusion strategy should be timely, effective, complete, safe, and easily accessible to all. Next slide, please. There can be three modalities of reperfusion. First is primary PCI, second is thrombolysis, the third is lysis, followed by PCI, that is pharmaco-invasive approach. We will see one by one. In primary PCI, when the patient presents within 90 minutes to the cath lab, where the cath lab is nearby, so he will be subjected to coronary angioplasty. This is the gold standard treatment of acute ST elevation myocardial infarction. If cath lab facility is not there, if he approaches the hospital within 30 minutes, the ideal time to start thrombolysis. Where he is thrombolized with the thrombolytic agent, then within 3 to 24 hours, he can be transferred to a cath lab and can undergo angioplasty there. This approach of thrombolysis followed by coronary angioplasty, it is called pharmaco-invasive approach. Next slide, please. As I said earlier, PCI is the gold standard, preferred, but less accessible. We are thankful to our government because in most of the hospitals, government has started various yojanas, various schemes like Rajiv Gandhi or Arogya Shri. Under that, free of cost, it is done. It's a very great boon to the poor patients. Otherwise, it is very expensive. But unfortunately, it is less accessible to our patients staying in villages. Thrombolysis, it is easily available. It is also freely charged in government hospitals where they are recognized under various yojanas. It is economical. If you compare the efficacy of PCI versus thrombolysis, PCI takes the upper hand as far as short and long-term outputs are concerned. Patient has the option of pharmaco-invasive approach after thrombolysis if PCI cannot be performed due to a long distance of cath lab. He can be later subjected to intervention. And so this becomes an attractive option for bridging the gap between primary PCI and thrombolysis. Next slide, please. Coming down to the advantages of thrombolytic therapy, hence, in future, our talk will be related to only thrombolytic therapy. So it has got great benefit if it is the patient is treated with this modality from symptom onset within 1 hour with a sharp drop of the benefit after 3 hours. As I said in that slide of Eugene Braunwald, sir, and Bernard Gertz, sir, if you thrombolyze patient within half an hour to 1 hour, approximately 95 to 100% of the myocardium is salvaged or saved. On the contrary, if you thrombolyze after 3 to 4 hours, approximately 60 to 70% of the myocardium is gone. Early thrombolysis within 6 hours prevents approximately 3% of the deaths. And this modality in our country is most commonly commonly a practiced form of reperfusion in our country. Next slide, please. Now you have to decide which thrombolytic agent you are going to choose among the various thrombolytic agents which are available. You are the one who is going to take the decision. Next slide, please. There is a turf battle war between streptokinase, etiplase, and tenecteplase. Who will win the war and who will form the government? Who will take over the charge? When I was a student during my PG days, streptokinase used to form the government or rule the capital. Nowadays, it is less used because of the so many drawbacks. I will later comment about them. Second is etiplase, and third one is tenecteplase. We'll see one by one. Next slide, please. Can you move to next one? Now, regarding streptokinase, the failure rate is 55%, and the patency rate is only 54%. So, successful thrombolysis rate is only 45%. So, not a good option. Earlier, we was not having any option. That's why we are going with this. But now, it is not useful. Next. More than half of the patients, they are not thrombolyzed. When this fibrin-specific agent is recommended, European Society has recommended, given it as a 1A recommendation, 1B recommendation. Or when this fibrinolysis as a reperfusion strategy is recommended to initiate the treatment immediately after staining, and the most importantly, pre-hospital setting, recommendation is 1A. So they are promoting pre-hospital administration of thrombolytic agent. And regarding tenecteplase, half dose has to be used if the patient is above 75 years of age. Next slide, please. So fibrin-specific agent is the drug of choice. So here you can see streptokinase has got tendency to create allergic reactions, which is not there with other agents like antiplase, etiplase, and tenecteplase. Plasminogen activation, as far as plasminogen activation goes, it doesn't cause any activation, whereas it is the tenecteplase which causes maximum plasminogen activation, which ultimately creates plasmin, a proteolytic enzyme, which lyses the clot. Fibrin specificity is very, very less with streptokinase. It is very high with tenecteplase. As regards dose, 15 lakh units to be given over 60 minutes in case of strepto. Multiplies here, it has to be given in a bolus dose of 15, followed by remaining up to 85 in 90 minutes infusion. Whereas retiplase, you have to give in 34 minutes, 10 units over 2 minutes, 30 minutes apart. So 34 minutes total. Whereas tenecteplase is given within 5 seconds only, you can give bolus dose of 0.53 milligram per kg. Within 5 seconds only, you can give it. You can give it outside the hospital also. It's a very great advantage with tenecteplase. So as regards plasminogen activation inhibitor resistance is concerned, it is not seen in any of the three first, and it is seen with tenecteplase. So plasminogen activator inhibitor doesn't have any role to bring down the plasminogen, because that is the quality of the tenecteplase which it has. As regards patency at 90 minutes, it is maximum with tenecteplase, minimum with streptokinase. As regards TME grade 3 flow, it is maximum with tenecteplase, above 63-64. And systemic fibrinogen depletion, it is maximum with streptokinase and minimum with tenecteplase. Next slide, please. So streptokinase is not fibrin specific, which, as I said earlier, eventually, there is a depletion of plasminogen. It is also called as plasminogen steal, which prevents fibrinolytic action, accounting partly for the thrombolysis failure. Next slide, please. Now we'll compare tenecteplase with streptokinase. There is one study conducted by Himmat Rao, S. Bhavaskar and others, where they compared streptokinase with tenecteplase in ST elevation myocardial infarction in peripheral hospital. We will see what were their observations. Total in this study, they enrolled 2009 patients, and 162 patients received streptokinase, and rest of the patients they received tenecteplase. The parameters which they assessed were the time interval between chest pain to hospital, hospital to needle time, reperfusion and arrhythmias, and time required for regression of ST elevated ST segment in response to thrombolytic therapy, streptokinase or tenecteplase therapy. So what was the result? Next slide, please. You can see in streptokinase group, there were 18 deaths, very quite a significant deaths, whereas in tenecteplase, there were only 3 deaths. And failure of thrombolysis was seen in 17 patients. And here it is seen in only 5 patients, significant p-value. And death at the end of 1 year was seen in 12 patients, and there was 0 death after 1 year. Again, significant p-value. So here the tenecteplase has again won the match. Next slide, please. One more study, it was conducted in Russian country. Again, tenecteplase was compared with streptokinase. As far as they have observed the TIMI-3 flow, which is the flow which takes place after the thrombolytic agent is given. So this TIMI-3 flow with tenecteplase group was approximately 74.5%, as against 31.9% seen with the streptokinase. TIMI-2 was 18.6 in tenecteplase, and it was 20.5 in streptokinase. TIMI-1 is 11.2 versus 16.5 in TIMI-0. Just I will tell you for beginners what is this TIMI blood flow is. After giving thrombolysis, when there is, if you do angiography and if you see there is dye is not crossing the lesion, it is called TIMI-0 flow. In TIMI-1 flow, there is slight amount of dye seen in the culprit vessel, and distal territory is devoid of reperfusion. Whereas in TIMI-2, culprit vessel is filled, but targeted area is not fully supplied. Whereas in TIMI-3 blood flow, you will see a normal coronary blood flow with fully supplied regional territory. So TIMI-3 flow after a thrombolysis is always a good indicator of a successful thrombolysis, which is seen in 74.5% of the patient in tenecteplase group. Again here, tenecteplase wins the match against the streptokinase. Next slide, please. To this slide, I will come after a few slides. Here they have shown this slide was in the European Society of Cardiology Congress in 2017. They advised thrombolysis with fibrinolytic agent within 10 minutes. Bolus fibrinolytic should be given within 10 minutes. If the PCI is not accessible, approach PCI takes more than 120 minutes. If it takes less than 120 minutes, better to go for primary PCI. And that PCI center should be alerted, and patient should be transferred there with those patients having ST elevation MI. If time required to reach cath lab is more than 120 minutes, bolus of fibrinolytic should be given within 10 minutes, and immediately within 2 hours or within 1.5 hour, patient, if he meets the reperfusion criteria, then he should be subjected for routine PCI strategy. If no, then if there is a failed thrombolysis, then rescue PCI should be done. Next slide, please. Like I said, in fibrinolysis strategy, the goal is to inject the bolus of fibrinolytic within 10 minutes from STEMI diagnosis. Within 10 minutes, bolus of fibrinolytic should be given. longer the administration time. Like I said, in regard to step two queries, it takes approximately 30 to 60 minutes. And regarding ready place, around 34 minutes. Regarding Altiplex, it takes around 90-85 minutes. So as far as this Tenecteplex is concerned, only within 5 seconds you can do the bolus dose. So this is a great advantage of Tenecteplex over other thrombolytic agents. Next. Something to tell about Retiplex. It has been approved in 1996. Its thrombolytic potency is 2+, and I said earlier, time taken for administration is 34 minutes, and 90-minute patency rate goes up to 84%. Fibrin affinity is 1+, specificity is 2+, and PAI, plasminogen activator inhibitor resistance, is not there, and fibrin systemic fibrin depletion is moderate. And TIMI grade 3 flow, which I said earlier, it is 60% with the Retiplex. And there is no weight adjusted dose, so it's a great drawback. There are high chances that patient may get overdose or underdose. So we have, in case of Retiplex, in terms of milligram per kg dose, so accurate dosing can be calculated. Mortality is around 7.45% within 1 month, and it can be up to 9.7% after 1 year. And for door to needle time of 30 minutes, it is not suitable. Door to needle time, DN time, 30 minutes. Here it takes 34 minutes, as I said. So it is not suitable for DN, door to needle time of 30 minutes. Not a favorable molecule. Next slide, please. Here you can see very well. Earlier I have described this slide. Nothing again new to say. Only a few things I would like to say. All the benefits goes with Tenecteplex, like fibrin specificity, resistance to PAI, and TIMI grade 3 flow, maximum with Tenecteplex. One more thing, hypotension part was not mentioned over here. The hypotension is seen with this molecule, streptokinase, when we were in our PG days. It is not seen with Tenecteplex. Next slide, please. When you compare TNK with Retiplex, Tenecteplex was approved in 2000 and Retiplex was approved in 1996. Potency, thrombolytic potency is 3+ in TNK, in Retiplex it is 2+. See the magic over here. Time taken for administration is only 5 seconds. Here it is 34 minutes. 90-minute patency rate goes up to 85%, Retiplex 84%. Minimal difference. But other, this benefit is a very great benefit as shown by EASC guidelines current last year. Fibrin affinity is very good. Fibrin specificity is very good. And PA1 resistance is seen, which is not seen with Retiplex. And coming down to weight adjusted, facility is there, as I said earlier, it is not there with Retiplex. Overdosing and underdosing can take place with Retiplex. Mortality is less as compared to Retiplex. So door to needle time of 30 minutes, this molecule fulfills the criteria. Yes, here Retiplex cannot be given. So in our country, there are so many trials. So we'll see in future slides in regards to Tenecteplex. Not a single trial has been conducted or Retiplex. There are so many trials on a very huge number of patients regarding Tenecteplex, which are published in very reputed journals of international repute. Next slide, please. I think we have discussed this slide. Next slide, please. So you can skip this slide, please. Please skip this slide, this also. So here you can see, as far as fibrin specificity, 1B recommendation by European Society of Cardiology. For streptokinase, it is 0, Altiplex 2+, Retiplex 1+, and Tenecteplex 3+. 1A recommendation by ESC for bolus administration within 10 minutes. This criteria is fulfilled by only 10 ATPase. No other molecule has the guts to fulfill this quality. So 1A, 1B recommendation for a thrombolytic agent. So it is highly recommended. You should try this agent for your patients to get the best of the best benefit to your patients. Next slide, please. So here I said no streptokinase, no ATPase, 10 ATPase clearly wins the race over here. Next slide. Because of our fibrin specificity and bolus for quick thrombolysis, both the qualities are very well shared by 10 ATPase, 1B and 1A recommendation by ESC. So 10 ATPase. Next slide, please. There are 2 to 3 trials. I will share two studies. One conducted by Dr. S.S. Iyengar, Tini Nair, Jagdish Sheremat, and Uday Jadhav sir, and others. It was published in Indian Heart Journal, where they have tried this molecule in approximately 15,000 patients, and data was collected, and we'll see the results. Next, clinically successful thrombolysis from the time of presentation, overall it was seen in 95.43%, quite a significant number. If given within 3 hours, again better, 96.54. If thrombolyzed between 3 to 6 hours, 96.07% clinically successful CST. And if it is given after 6 hours, a bit less, 85.38% is the CST. So it confirms that this 10 ATPase has successfully proved to be a good molecule as regards as regards thrombolytic agent. Next slide, please. Another study where the almost similar authors, it was conducted in 2017, published in JAPI, 65th volume, they conducted over 7,500 Indian patients who had ST elevation myocardial infarction. So what they found was, next slide please. Overall rate of achieving complete successful therapy with 10 ATPase was 93.34%, and 93.2% patient had chest pain resolution. 91% patients had 50% resolution of ST elevation at 90 minutes. Very much successful thrombolysis. And mortality was only 0.69% before the discharge. Only 53 patients died. Incidence of bleeding was negligible. Only 1.77 non-neurological. And ICH was seen in only 0.38 and 0.18 without ICH stroke. So bleeding risk was very minimum. Next slide, please. So the conclusion, the finding of this study further use important or reinforces the safety of this molecule in Indian patients presenting with ST elevation. What I am trying to tell. Next slide. One more study where the primary PCI was compared with pharmaco-invasive strategies. Now today topic of debate. So what they tried to show in this study, which was published in Journal of Cardiovascular Disease in 2018, that immediate thrombolysis followed by invasive angioplasty was compared with primary PCI without giving a thrombolytic agent, and the short-term outcome was almost similar in both. So there was not much difference. So if one doesn't get the facility of primary PCI due to some technical problem, he should avail the facility of pharmaco-invasive strategy. This has been shown in this paper very nicely. Next slide, please. Similar thing here in is shown that pharmacotherapy is recommended in ST elevation MI patients in metro and tier one cities of India, if there is any delay to the access to, if delay is anticipated. So in place of strategy of promoting only primary PCI, one should promote pharmacoimaging therapy also, in which initially a thrombolytic agent is given, followed by a PTC is done. So to conclude my talk, to my take-home message is that during this COVID time, it's a hard time, it's a challenging time, the world is passing through. So management of any disorder is difficult during this time. ST elevation myocardial infarction or heart attack being an emergency. So I decided to speak on this. So I have spoken about the challenges which we have to face during the management of this critical condition. And also I have tried to elaborate on various methods of reperfusion and various trials regarding pharmacoinvasive versus primary PCI. So I conclude here. I thank you very much for kind listening. Thank you very much. In audience, if they have the questions, then they can post in the chat box.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for your very insightful, detailed talk for on this important topic. Now I would request delegates, if you are having any questions, you can unmute yourself and you can really ask your questions directly to sir, or you can put your questions in chat box also. We'll read the questions for you.
Vikrant will take questions from chat box.
Yeah. We'll take the questions.
We'll take questions from
present
chat
in chat box first. Yeah. There are so many comments. Okay. Sir, first is question is from Dr. Sachin Patange. Question is, what is the mechanism of action of tenecteplase in the management of AMI?
As I said, is a tenecteplase is a thrombolytic agent. It converts plasminogen to plasmin. Plasmin is a fibrinolytic proteolytic enzyme. So thrombus being a platelet fibrin rich clot, so it lyses the thrombus with the help of plasmin proteolytic enzyme. So conversion of plasminogen to plasmin is the mechanism of action of tenecteplase.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Dr. Abdul Azim. Question is, how serious is STEMI heart attack?
How serious is ST elevation myocardial? It is a very critical condition. If tackled timely and neatly, patient can be saved. If not tackled properly or not handled properly, it can be life taking and death can take place. So it should be taken very seriously. ST elevation.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Dr. Abdul Ghafoor. Question is, with the patient, how to quickly conclude between the chest discomfort and its STEMI as the time is running out?
So here applies the physician's clinical skill, and with the help of some investigations, whenever a patient of chest pain comes to you, whenever patient gets chest pain, better he should consult a physician or a cardiologist. Physician or cardiologist will be in a better position to evaluate correctly. You should not arrive on your own, I'm having chest pain because of this or that. Mainly cardiac anginal pain is squeezing type of crushing pain, most of the time radiating to left arm or associated with sweating. So different kind of chest pains, they have different modalities of presentation. It is difficult to cover in this talk. It will take much long time. Better to consult the doctor, physician, cardiologist. He will evaluate by doing certain tests, ECG, troponin, like that.
Next question is from Dr. Lalita. How is disinfection is carried out at place like Nanded in ICU if MI patient COVID positive?
Usually after discharging the patient, we sanitize with 1% hypochlorite solution. 1% hypochlorite solution. It is recommended by government also. So 1% hypochlorite solution we suggest.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Dr. Nikita. Question is, how to assess failed thrombolysis?
See, there are three ways in which you can assess failed thrombolysis. One is clinically, patient will have persistent chest pain despite thrombolysis. He will not be relieved of chest pain. Second thing, ST elevation fall will be less than 50%. Reduction in ST elevation will not be, it will not come down to baseline. It will be less than 50%. And third thing, which will point out towards failed thrombolysis is absence of reperfusion and arrhythmia. If there is a successful thrombolysis, you may get VPBs or some atrial ectopics. So they point towards successful thrombolysis. Clinically, absence of chest pain, full ST elevation coming to baseline, presence of reperfusion arrhythmias. They point out towards successful thrombolysis and vice versa.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Dr. Lalita. Nowadays, plasma antibodies are infused. How the lab functions are maintained in COVID positive? Uses of steroids in MI in COVID positive. I think there are two questions.
I will try to answer second question. First question I could not understand. Regarding steroid use in myocardial infarction and COVID, steroids are controversial in COVID. They are used in COVID complicated cases like ARDS, like that. If patient has ARDS and AMI simultaneously, then you have to see risk and benefit. How much is the risk in giving steroid? So steroid acids, they are not good for in the set of acute AMI. But you have to see if this cytokine storm is there, patient is in full-blown ARDS, your priority is to control ARDS part first. So steroids in minimum dose you can use. I think you have to balance the situation. What was the first question?
First question was, nowadays plasma antibodies are infused. How the lab functions are maintained in COVID positive?
How the lab functions are maintained?
Maintained in COVID, in COVID positive.
Which lab functions?
I think if Dr. Lalita is listening to this, he can throw some light on this question if it is possible.
Yeah.
You can unmute yourself and you can ask the question. Dr. Lalita.
I think with the lab, those labs who are handling the samples of COVID patient, they should take all the precautions like PPE and all. If they are transfusing antibodies, plasma therapy and all, similar principle applies. Whoever is handling a simple throat swab, he has to take the same precaution as the one who is doing plasma transfusion. Same principle applies as far as prevention is concerned.
Okay. Next question is, apart from performing SMS, do you recommend inhaling steam and drinking hot lemon water on daily basis as precautionary measure to protect oneself from COVID-19?
No, it is not a substitute. It can be supplementation. Apart from the SMS, you can do that thing. Because with the hot water and all, this virus will be killed. It will be a supplementation. It will not be a substitution to SMS. SMS is mandatory. It is a compulsory thing.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Next question. Doctor, you mean to say that post-tenecty plus angioplasty results in better myocardial reperfusion and will be a good option in this trying situation?
Yeah, I feel so. Thrombolysis is better option in this COVID pandemic.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Next question is from Dr. Nikita. Why urokinase is not used in ST elevation myocardial infarction nowadays?
Urokinase has got its own drawbacks, like it can cause bleeding tendency, it can produce hypotension. So it is usually not advocated because you have very good other safe agents. Why to go with those old agents which have more side effects. Urokinase is nowadays, it is recommended for vascular thrombolysis in peripheral vessels or pulmonary embolism. I heard somewhere last week, I read this one article. Urokinase was tried in intrapleural lysis of septations in incisional empyema. And in pulmonary embolism, it was tried. But in cardiac stimulation MI, I don't think urokinase, it is filled with a lot of side effects.
Next question is from Dr. Maliha. What is the difference between facilitated PEI and pharmacoinvasive PEI approach, and which approach is better?
I think it is facilitated PCI versus pharmacoinvasive PCI. Facilitated PCI is you perform primary angioplasty with prior giving antiplatelet GP2B inhibitors like abciximab or tarofibab. You give that first and then you perform angioplasty. It is called facilitated PCI, primary PCI. Whereas in pharmacoinvasive approach, you initially routine thrombolysis with tenecteplase. Then after that, you pose the patient for PCI. Right?
Right, sir. Thank you. Next question is from Dr. Abdul Azim. Doctor, which is worse, STEMI or NSTEMI?
I could not under NSTEMI. What is NSTEMI?
Non-STEMI.
Non-STEMI. ST elevation MI is always danger than non-ST elevation MI, because there is complete occlusion of the coronary vessel in ST elevation MI. In non-ST elevation MI, there is partial obstruction of the coronary lumen. So damage will be more in ST elevation MI as compared to non-ST elevation.
Next question is from Dr. Abdul Azim Undi. Doctor, how serious is STEMI heart attack? And what happens during STEMI?
During ST elevation myocardial infarction, this plaque which is there in the coronary artery, it gets ruptured. And because of that, the fat molecules which are present inside the plaque, they come in contact with the platelets and they form the thrombus, which occludes the lumen and which blocks the coronary artery, thereby blocking the blood flow to the distal territory of the myocardium. This is the pathogenesis of the myocardial infarction. Because is dead, so it can't, is a deadly condition. If not timely open that culprit vessel, then it can cause dire consequences. So it is one of the very critical condition if not tackled very promptly. I hope
doctor,
that I answer that.
Yes, sir. Dr. Abdul Azim again asked, one second, which artery is blocked in STEMI and what causes STEMI?
ST elevation myocardial infarction, STEMI can happen because of the occlusion of any one of the three coronary arteries. It's not like that only one coronary artery could cause. Could be LCA, it could be RCA, it could be left circumflex. Then mechanism, I said, rupture of atherosclerotic plaque and formation of thrombus.
Again, the question is from Dr. Abdul Azim Undi. How STEMI is diagnosed? And how does a STEMI feel like?
It is diagnosed, STEMI is diagnosed on the clinically on the basis of presentation of chest pain. It has a very characteristic type of chest pain. Then again, on if you go to perform some investigation, on ECG also you can diagnose there should be ST elevation more than two consecutive leads, more than three complexes. And there are certain laboratories values also attached in the diagnostic criteria. Troponin I or CPK MB should be elevated. I mean, these criteria are met, then one can diagnose acute myocardial infarction.
Doctor, what are the four signs of an impending heart attack?
Comment on these four signs of impending MI. Usually, patient will have some kind of fatigueness, some breathing difficulty, or sweating, shortness of breath, like that. A typical chest pain might be there. You actually practically cannot predict when the person is going to have heart attack.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Dr. Vilas. What precautions a diabetic hypertensive patient should take during lockdown?
Nice questions, applicable to all, because lot many patients are having diabetes and hypertension. They are now trapped because of this lockdown period. So one important thing is that because of lockdown, they are unable to perform routine exercises. Outdoor activities are hampered because of this. So they should perform exercise at home. They can use, they can take help of treadmill or cycling, can do yoga, or they can do some kind of exercise at home. And they should monitor their blood sugar. They should monitor their blood pressure. Nowadays, glucometry is available. BP apparatus machine is available. So they should be very much careful. And as compared to general public, the risk of complication, if these patient catches fluid infection, risk of dying or risk of complications are more, as we all know, in diabetic and hypertensive patients. So they should execute these precautions more.
Next question is, how long DAPT should be given after AMI?
Usually, recommendation is for 6 months, you should give DAPT. After 6 months, patient can be shifted to single antiplatelet. For 6 months, at least, you should give double antiplatelet.
Next question is from Dr. Jayashree. What is subendocardial infarction?
Subendocardial infarction is nothing but non-ST elevation MI. Earlier, it was called subendocardial MI, or it is also called as non-QO MI. So non-ST, non-STEMI is same as subendocardial MI, or non-QMI is also called as subendocardial MI.
Okay, thank you, sir. Next question is from Dr. Abdul Ghafoor. How to diagnose a patient very quickly from common chest discomfort and STEMI as the time is running? I think you answered this question, sir. There is a compliment from Dr. Lalita. Very lucid, informative talk.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
There is one more question from Dr. Siddiqui. If a patient comes with acute severe chest pain in a basic OPD setup without ECG support, then what supportive treatment should we give other than aspirin till he reaches higher center?
Best to place sorbitrate sublingually and send him to the physician. First, the general practitioner should be able to differentiate. So you should have some knowledge of angina, or cardiac chest pain. You should use loading dose of aspirin, clopidogrel, and put sorbitrate below his tongue, and try to send him to nearby physician or ICU, wherever he wants to go.
Next question is from Dr. Siddiqui again. We saw first ECG comes normal sometimes, but ST elevation comes after a while. Why it is so?
See, when this occlusion takes place, coronary occlusion takes place, initially the microcirculation is there, which supplies the myocardium. So you may get initial ECG normal because of the blood supply by the microcirculation. When gradually, when the circulation decreases, then you will get the ECG changes. So ECG sensitivity and specificity is very less. One cannot rely on ECG. Only it is 35% to 40% diagnostic.
Next question is from Dr. Pradeep. role of heparin in STEMI, especially in periphery where thrombolytic facility is not available?
It will partly help. It will prevent thrombus from expanding. It will not lyse the thrombus. It will provide some help. It is better to give. It will at least prevent from expansion in the size of the thrombus, because it will prevent attaching platelets to the thrombus. So, but definitely thrombolysis or PCI is needed. Heparin is definitely is going to help if it is given in the primary setup to a patient of proven MI. Prevents expansion of clot.
Next question is from Dr. Maliha. COVID patients can take vitamin C supplements, which may help in rapid recovery from COVID. But high dosage supplements entails heart risk. What Dr. Maliha is saying. Dr. Siddiqui says, thanks a lot for clearing all our doubts. It was an excellent talk, very informative for us.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. These are the questions available so far in the chat box. Thank you so much for your valuable time for this important session. As you rightly mentioned in your talk, pharmacoinvasive approach will be a way ahead, and it will be a bridge to gap between STEMI, PCI and thrombolysis alone, especially in this COVID situation. And undisputed and the best thrombolytic is tenecteplase because of its own advantages, like 5-second IV bolus dose, PI resistance, less chances of bleeding, and weight-adjusted dose. And thank you so much. This informative talk will be very helpful for all the participant delegates and all the participants. Thank you so much. Now I would request Mr. Sharad to give a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Rafiq. Thank you for a very elaborate, informative, and very interactive session from your side. I really thank you. At the same time, I also like to thank all the delegates for sparing your time and on a Sunday evening. That's thank you so much for all of you. And once again, I thank all of you and Dr. Rafiq for attending this session. And I think with this, we'll conclude this session. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. We conclude the session here. Thank you.